it's Jon Regen with another episode of New York Notes here on Jazz Radio Berlin. What a special event we have for you this week. We have an entire hour dedicated to the music of jazz royalty. I'm talking about bass legend Ron Carter. And not only do we have the music of Ron Carter all episode long, we have Ron Carter joining us to talk about his music and his latest happenings. So let's start this very special episode of New York Notes out with one of my favorite tracks that features Ron Carter. This comes from Branford Marsalis's album Royal Garden Blues, one of the albums that got me interested in jazz in the first place. And this is the Ellis Marsalis classic, Swingin' at the Haven. This is Jazz Radio, Berlin.
Thank you.
That was saxophonist Branford Marsalis with the track Swingin' at the Haven, featuring his father Ellis Marsalis, who wrote that song, and our special guest this week, Ron Carter on the bass, and Ralph Peterson on the drums. And another track that features our guest this week, Ron Carter on the bass, comes from Harry Connick Jr.'s self-titled debut album from back in 1987. I remember this album very well because I was working at a record store the summer before I went to music school, and I couldn't get enough of this record. And this is a duet between Ron Carter and Harry Connick Jr., a rare instrumental track for Harry. And this is entitled Vocation. You're listening to Jazz Radio Berlin. Thank you. That was Harry Connick Jr. with the track Vocation in a duo setting with this week's very special guest, Ron Carter. And Ron Carter also appears on this next track from the Joe Henderson sextet album, The Kicker, from back in 1967. This one has special significance to me because it features my mentor, the great pianist Kenny Barron. Check out the title track from Joe Henderson, The Kicker, right now on Jazz Radio Berlin. That was the Joe Henderson sextet with the track The Kicker, featuring our special guest this week, Ron Carter, as well as my mentor, the great pianist Kenny Barron. Ron Carter and Kenny Barron also appear on the next track from vocalist Jimmy Scott. This track has a whole lot of significance to me because it was one of the first things I heard when I got asked to accompany Jimmy Scott as his pianist, and I studied this album like an encyclopedia before I got on stage for the first time with Jimmy. Nobody had a voice like this guy, and nobody plays bass like Ron Carter. Check out All the Way.
Somebody loves you. It's no good unless she loves you. All the way. Happy to be near you. When you need someone to cheer you. All the way. Taller than the tallest tree. That's how it's got to go. Deeper. How deep it goes, if it's real. When somebody needs you, it's no good unless she needs you.
That was vocalist Jimmy Scott with his rendition of All the Way, featuring Kenny Barron on the piano, and this week's special guest, legendary bassist Ron Carter. And joining us now is that legendary bassist. He's played on over 2,200 albums, many which you probably have already in your collection. And his taste and time and touch on his instrument are just unparalleled. So, Ron Carter, thanks for joining me on New York Notes this week.
Thanks for the time in your calendar.
Ron, I must confess that I've had many things in my life that have happened to me that I would consider exciting and an achievement. But having you follow me on social media may just take the cake. But in all seriousness, it's great to see you, as well as so many other musicians that I respect, really harnessing the power of social media to stay connected, to get their music and their message out, and really keep a vibrant presence while we're all waiting for the world to open back up.
Well, this is as close as I can get to my newly made friends in the audience and my older made friends from my past, kind of make a connection with them so they know that I'm fine. I'm as active as the society will allow me to be right now. I think about them. I hope that they're taking care of the business and wearing their masks and doing the proper things to help their neighbors get through the day. And in general, looking forward to this is a great big intermission, and we're glad when it's over.
I can imagine it must be strange for you after many decades of nonstop work, performing, recording, touring, to have this much time off.
Well, what it made me do, John, with no age, is to my students, I still have them over the summer, and now that school is back, I have the second semester of my year with them. They've recommended things that they've had time to do since there's been no class, and they've been kind of locked in their homes, as most of us have, that they play certain records for me that I've made some years ago, and I've forgotten about them, so they've forced me to do my research at their insistence, and I'm surprised at the things that came out.
You know, Ron, in preparing for this interview, I went back into my own personal record collection, and so many of the records that you've played on over the years, and they're thousands of them, but they mean so much to so many of us, whether we're musicians or listeners. They're touchstones in our lives, from the albums you made with Miles and Herbie and Wayne, and on to the thousands of other records that you played on. What is it about these albums and these eras that keep us intrigued and enveloped in the music?
But I think one of the things that these records represent, a big thing, is the sound of the disc. Rudy Van Gelder studio was where they were most all made, and Rudy, as you know, was the master, represents the sound of the jazz record. And these discs that came out of Blue Note, you know, Prestige, CTI, you know, some Verve, they all have that Rudy Van Gelder sound, and that sound of the instruments, the purity, the consistency, the identification of who's playing it, because Rudy's sound was so specific, I think is one of the things that attracts people to these general records, is the recorded sound. The second thing, John, is that they were all 12 inches so people could read about the record. They could read about the personnel. They could read about maybe the circumstances under which this record was being made. They were placed in the studio just because of the size and the photographs involved with this music. I think the third thing is the quality of these records is so high due to the conditions under which they were made. Most of them were made under the conditions that we had one day to make this record. That they limited or maybe most times no overdubbing. There would be no more than two takes because we had to do a record from 9 o'clock until it was finished, which would be about dark in New York most of the time, and we all had other gigs to do. I think the intensity of these records, given those parameters, people still feel it, not knowing what that is that draws them back to the records. But I think those four items are some of the things that we could look to as touchstones that make this record really valuable as a listener to sit on and enjoy on any kind of evening.
Well, we're celebrating your music all episode long, but you have chosen two tracks in particular to share with our listeners here on New York Notes. And the first one is rather surprising. It comes from your 1995 album, Brandenburg Concerto, and it's box Brandenburg Concerto number 3. Let's take a listen to that, and then we're going to come back and chat with jazz legend Ron Carter some more. This is Jazz Radio Berlin.
this is Ron Carter. I'm in New York right now, and I hope you're tuned to Jazz Radio Berlin with your host and my friend, Jon Regen.
That was this week's special guest, Ron Carter, with an excerpt from his album, Brandenburg Concerto, and the track Bach Brandenburg Concerto No. 3. That's from 1995. And Ron Carter is still with us. Ron, it occurs to me that so many of my musical heroes, yourself included, evinced this musical grace and humility and mastery. I hope that's not lost on the future generations to come.
Well, it sounds like you're kind of like me. When I heard those early Gil Evans records, I was so taken back by the voicing and the sound of the instruments and where he placed them in his chord structure and in his arrangements. And when they were recorded, later I got a chance to work with him for 8 weeks in the club in New York, and I made some records with him. Later on, he got updated his stuff and became a more electrified band, and I was disappointed because it wasn't the sound that I grew to like. I understood that progress is what it is, and of course we can't go back to the street lights lit by a kerosene lamp anymore. But that itself is such a romantic image, you know, like the old lamplighter, so to speak. I think we're looking at those times, and hopefully that now that the vinyl is coming back and those discs that were made during the times we're referring to right now will make the young people, the younger musicians, the younger audiences step back and say, well, what was before MP4? Or MP3, or file sharing. What was before then? And maybe they'll step back and say, this is what we've been missing, and apply that kind of vibe, I hate that word, to what they tried to do 15 years later after the sound.
You know, before the internet ruined our collective attention spans, I remember being able to put a CD on and listen to it the entire way through or get lost in a side of an album. Sometimes I miss those days of being able to concentrate more instead of being addicted to my phone. I remember Donald Fagen told me he calls people like that palm people because they're staring at their palms all the time.
Well, I think a couple of things. Right now, people only have their palms to look at due to where we are, you know. And one of the differences between that and playing for an audience is the audience is literally breathing with you because they're in the same physical space, you know. And that kind of precludes, we all get upset when you see people walk down the street, they run into you, or they walk into the proverbial post with their iPhones on their forehead. You know, we kind of enjoy that humor despite the pain, temporary as it is, that's been inflicted on their forehead. They're so involved in their own world because that's all they have. And it's difficult for many things to get past that veil of person, you know. But when they're in the room with any other bodies, whether it's 4 or 404 or 4,004, they're part of their collective breathing, whether they are physically aware of it or not, and that helps the music have another life. And I think as soon as we get out of this intermission, we'll have to come back because people will insist on no longer breathing on their own, so to speak. It'll get with other people who will help them share the air. In this case, help them share the feelings of the music, to share the ups and downs, the highs and lows, the intensity. I'm looking forward to those days when we can share those kind of emotions with them.
Ron, having made so many albums that so many of us hold dear, what are some of the things you want people to take away from the artistry and the legacy that you've created and the music that you've made?
John, with no age, that's about 6 questions. I try to answer 3 of them, and maybe they'll cover the other 3. One thing I try to tell my students who are getting involved in the industry is as a freelancer, and bass players all do that. There's no question about that. I have 3 things in mind, and I want to share that with them. One of the things is that when I leave my home, I'll leave my ego on my doorstep. And I'll borrow a second pair of ears to help this gig help me hear better. The second thing I do is I listen in stereo or cineramic sound. I try to hear all the parts that are coming at me with information. I try to pick on all of them because they affect the trajectory of my line, my intonation, my rhythm. And the third thing is to remember that we're all in this soup together. And the only way the soup works is that all the ingredients are doing their share. I think bass players have kind of gotten away from doing their share waiting for the Baby Pinks to come on, and they get the sound and says, now we'll feature our bass player. Well, you have to step back from that feature word and understand that you're the straw that stirs the drink, you know, and you can appreciate that. The other thing I try to tell people in general is that the word jazz has so many types and styles of music. You know, if you really want to understand what the music is, I recommend that they pick, you know, ask someone maybe like me or Kenny Barron, pick about 8 or 9 records that they could listen to get a view of the width and breadth of the music and see which style that's under this rubric called jazz best fits their temperament. I want them to be the deciding factor, what they think it is. I keep trying to find the best notes and the right notes and presenting me. It's up to them to accept this view as one view that they find is very satisfactory for their definition of what jazz is for them, this broad body of audience.
Lessons we can all take to heart. Ron Carter, thanks so much for joining me on New York Notes this week. We're going to play another track that you've hand-selected for our listeners. This is from the album All Alone and the track DB Blues. Thanks so much.
Stay well. Bye.
This is Jazz Radio Berlin. Thank you. That was this week's special guest, bassist Ron Carter, with the track DB Blues from his album All Alone. Big thanks to Ron Carter for stopping by New York Notes this week. Let's continue our celebration of the music featuring Ron Carter with a track that can only be called a classic. This is Herbie Hancock with Cantaloupe Island. You're listening to Jazz Radio Berlin. That was Herbie Hancock with the classic track Cantaloupe Island from the album Empyrean Isles. That features Freddie Hubbard on the trumpet and Tony Williams on the drums. And this week's special guest, Ron Carter, on the bass. Let's close out our Ron Carter celebration with a track from the classic Wayne Shorter album, Speak No Evil. This is Infant Eyes. I'll be back next week for another episode of New York Notes. Who knows what we will discover together. Thanks for listening. See you real soon. Mm-hmm.